You're listening to the Light Novel Podcast. Visit us online at lightnovelpodcast.com.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is the Light Novel Podcast, and I'm going to be your host, BioGundam. Now, for the astute listener, you may notice that Justice is no longer hosting. And for anyone who didn't see that video, basically for personal reasons, Justice decided to take a break. So I'm basically running the podcast. Joining me tonight, we've got John Luke.
Hello, people.
We have got Kyle.
Hola.
And my favorite punching bag, Mirage.
Good morning.
Excellent. So so today we're just going to be covering a bunch of licenses that Devin Sees, Yen Press, Jane of All Club covered, and we'll be doing some other miscellaneous podcasts as time goes on until Justice comes back from his vacation. So Mirage, what's the first thing on the agenda?
Yeah, the first new title is from Seven Seas, and the title in English is Disciple of the Lich. Japanese title is Fushisha no Deshi. It's an overlap title, and it's brand new. There's only one volume out in Japan, and it's released last year. An ordinary teenager is transported to a fantasy world, accidentally gets on the bad side of the gods, and is dumped in the bottom of the world's deepest dungeon with no skills or magic.
This sounds like discount F-Wetter.
Yeah. Once there, he meets a mysterious girl who happens to be undead, but despite her general dislike of humans, she decides to help him out. Can the two of them make it back to the surface? They might just be a more powerful combo than anyone was expecting.
So basically, discount F-Wetter meets necrophilia. Okay, I'm liking this already.
Well,
I mean, I was sold on necrophilia.
We have Arifueta, and then we had Failure Frame, and now we have the third series with the exact same setup.
Yeah, we've got the third series in the trilogy now.
Yeah, but this one has a cute mimic in the on the cover.
Oh, does it have a cute little mimic-chan?
Of course, that's probably the one thing that makes it worth reading.
You heard it from us, folks. Read it for the cute little mimic. Now, does anyone else have any thoughts on this before we move on?
Sounds like, you know, like quite a few that we've already covered. Although I wonder if Arifureta, if Yui counts as undead too, because, you know, she is a vampire.
She's a vampire, yes.
That is true. But I do remember that vampires usually in literature come in two types, the undead variety, or the one where they're like alive, but they're on like their own separate race.
Yeah, like, and like in Arifureta, they're just a separate race. They're not undead.
Shame. Oh, well, you know, it's putting a little, you know, a spin on it, you know, spooky, lewd lich skeleton. I like it.
I'm not sure if there will be much loot in this one.
Well, I guess I'm not going to read it then. So, Kyle, yeah, anything else before we move on?
No, just kind of seeing these patterns over and over again. I'm not quite sure what sets this one apart from, you know, the others.
I know a lot of, like, light novel authors get published off, like, Sosetsu, and they have their own, like, trends and shit. So It could be that this was the most popular out of, like, the trend of that particular, like, trend. So, I mean, I if it isn't from Sosetsu, I would be a little shocked, but if it's from Sosetsu, I wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah, well, most
releases are from Sosetsu.
Yeah, like, Faraway Paladin is from Sosetsu. So, alright, so let's move on to the next title.
Yeah, next title is also from Seven Seas, Loner Life in Another World. Japanese title, Hitoribochi no Isekai Kyoda Koryaku, also from Overlap, and from this we have six volumes out, and first release was in 2018. It seems the series is still ongoing, with the last release only out last month.
All right, so Kirby... it seems to be reasonably popular. So what's the synopsis? What's the blurb?
Yeah, when a Kerbic loner, Haruka, gets transported to another world with his class, he's not big on adventuring, but he wouldn't mind some cool magic on his own. Unfortunately, the magic powers are first come, first served, and by Haruka's turn, there's nothing good left to choose from. Now he'll have to take on this fantasy world with the hard way, with a hodgepodge selection of bizarre skills, and with all the girls in class tagging along.
Wow. This sounds like the guy who's trying to be like the cool, brooding loner, but has none of like the cool powers of the personality to back it up, and he just has a harem falling around. This sounds incredibly boring as fuck, but what do you guys think?
Well, I have like one thing that's bugging me about this title. Like, if you check the synopsis, it says that like he's traveling that world, a bunch of girls tagging along. And the title says that it's Loner Life. Like, yeah, doesn't even match. Loners
can get lots of girls in another world.
I mean, there's something like loners will work in groups, but like they're going to be more like a distant member of the group. Like, they won't take part much of the group dynamics, but does like, yeah, that doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
Well, go ahead.
Yeah, the one thing that I was noticing that it's again one isekai where the protagonist has a useless skill.
Yeah.
Or many useless skills in this
that
case.
That will turn out to be OP in the end.
Yeah. Sometimes, well, I wonder if the Japanese authors are there brainstorming now, what are useless skills that I could make OP somehow? Let's start writing a novel about it.
Well, the thing is, it's exactly like a lot of light novels. Like, some author just pick up a trend or an idea and they just, well, an idea that worked in another like series, and they just expand it to like expand and exaggerate it to like infinity and beyond. Like,
I mean, we have examples of that. Like, we have Cautious Hero. Like, it's literally about a guy who's like super overpowered, but it plays it so straight that it's funny.
Yeah, yeah, well, some authors give it an interesting twist, or some authors.
Yeah, so like the trend itself, like. The trend itself isn't exactly bad. Like, it's just a fad, you know. It's part of the market, because, you know, people on Sosetsu or wherever they're getting these stories from like that stuff. So obviously it's good. But, you know, like Mirage and said, there's like authors can give like a twist on it. I mean, we've got an example. Like, for example, we've got like Realist Hero and, you know, Kingdom of Wartania. I mean, very similar series, but very different in presentation.
Yeah,
and both of them are fairly good.
It's like everything. Like, take a business, for example. Like, if you want to start a business, you just look around, what do you want to do, what's been done, and you just try to do better. And that's the same thing with writing book, like arts and everything. But
that has been doing video games for decades now. Take something that works and make it better.
Yeah, but thing is, with the massive market,
new dog models,
like with the massive market, like you have a lot of similar thing coming out, and it's obvious that they're not all going to be good. So, but I think the problem is thinking that, oh no, another isekai, oh no, another like bottom tier skill that will make the character OP. But like, if you just dismiss a series because it's been done before, you might just overlook a hidden gem.
Yeah,
looks aren't everything. Like, when, for example, when I was like exploring anime and shit, like I used to read the synopsis, I'm just like, oh, this sounds stupid. But when I watched it, I'm just like, oh, you know, this isn't actually too bad. Like, you know, at least give some of these series a shot, because, you know, if you don't like it, then, well, you know, you just don't like it. But, you know, you'll find something.
Yeah,
usually for me to pick up a series like that, I would either have to hear someone review or read a review about it that says what is special about it or what makes it stand apart, or at least have the summary be more elaborate so that you can see what makes it stand out. And if it's just a three-line summary and that sounds exactly like another series that I've read before, then personally I have too many other series on my to-read list to bother.
Yeah.
Listen, even though I get for like a couple of novels a week, I still have a massive pile and shame in the corner.
Yeah.
But from what I caught of this series, like it seems like more of a comedic side than a more drama or serious one.
So it's kind of like a Cautious Hero type of thing. Like, I'm this cool loner by Batman isekai.
Probably, that could be fun for a laugh.
Kyle, do you have anything to say about it?
Yeah, I've actually read quite far into the series.
Okay, excellent. Oh. Yeah. Keep going.
Yeah, the thing.
Go
the
ahead.
Thing with, the thing with the loner part of it is that one of the only skills that remaining is it's almost like a curse where he can't join in the party of any other of his classmates. So he's kind of forced to do everything on his own.
Wow.
So yeah, so he's going to be, you know, a lower level than everybody else, lower stats than everybody else. He does have this skill. It's kind of like a pseudo dominance, but what it does is it just kind of has other people like tagging along for no particular reason. So it's more of an annoyance than anything.
Wow.
Yeah. So yeah, it is, I would say, partially comedy. There's definitely
primarily girls.
I'd say a majority girls, but you know, there are guys in the class too, because you know, it's not just him and by himself with all these other girls. No, there's other guys in the class. They kind of, you know, just, you know, it's really kind of weird because it's like they some groups naturally gravitate towards him. Like in the beginning, it's this, the trendy gals in the class, they start following him just because, you know, they ran into each other in the middle of a forest. And so after he's been on his own, surviving on his own, he made a cave by himself. And now he's got all these party crashers that he can't get rid of.
Oh my God, that sounds hilarious.
Yeah, that sounds good.
He's like, you know, I'm weak as shit, but I managed to make it alone. I got this nice cave. Mm-hmm. I'm like, hey, aren't those my classmates? Oh no.
Yeah.
Okay, that's
self-reliant. And independent. Okay, so the show, like, okay, so this book's sounding a lot better than I first thought. Anything else, or?
Yeah, I think the worst things that you're thinking of aren't going to be happening because there hasn't really been much of any fan service or any, like, elements.
Oh, thank fucking God.
Hey, you told me.
Yeah, so.
Okay, cool. So let's move on to the next title. Mirage, take it away.
Next title, last one from Seven Seas for today. My status as an assassin obviously exceeds the heroes, and now let me try the Japanese title. Ansatsusha de aru ore no status ga yushi yori mo akiraka ni tsuyoi no daga. So, when Akira's class is magically summoned to another world, he and his classmates are awarded fantastical powers, but while one of them is lucky enough to become a true hero, Akira becomes a mere assassin. However, against all odds, the assassin just might be the most powerful role of all. Harboring doubts about the intentions of the king, Akira uses his newfound strength as a master of the shadows to uncover the secrets and conspiracies of the crown.
Yep, so AKA his classmates are fucked.
Yeah. Three volumes out, started in 2017. Last volume released January 2019. So might be suspended or even finished. But I didn't find anything on that note.
Like I read a bit of the manga. Like, I just like the beginning. Like, in the manga, I read, like, the beginning parts of it. Like, he's just bonding with, like, this captain of the guard guy and his lieutenant. Like, literally, the guy literally looks like Reinhardt from Legend of Galactic Heroes. It's awesome. He's just, like, he's just chilling with the skinny guy, and they're talking about swordsmanship, and they're learning shit. And it's, like, pretty wholesome until tragedy strikes. But I'm not going to spoil that little detail. So, interesting anyone else have thoughts on it?
Well, I did also read it. A bit of manga like you, and I really don't know where I stand with this one. Like, it's interesting, but at the same time, it's like we said earlier, there was a lot of thing inside the story that I've already seen elsewhere, and nothing was really new per se. It's not bad in any mean, but it's just like, for me, it was missing like a little bit more oomph. Like, there was something missing, but still enjoyable. But, like, I think the thing that might set it apart is the fact that he just, like, he's, something bad happened. He's expelled from the group, or he flees away, meet an elf girl inside a cave, and a bunch of stuff happens. But at the same time, you also have, like, a small group of his classmate that finds out that there's something fishy going on in the kingdom, and decide to go on their own, trying to meet up with him, but they end up in a different country. And basically, it follows like the main character and that small group of students, and the rest that are, as Bio said, fought inside the castle. So so that's what I found interesting about it. But I don't know.
Don't trust do not go into a nice looking man's van just because he offers you magic powers. Okay.
Yeah. The basic premise of also sounds pretty similar to Ari Furetta.
Yeah, this is going to be a recurring theme throughout this podcast.
We talked about it earlier. All three Seven Seas titles are from Overlap, and all three are Isekai summons. So maybe it was kind of a package deal. So
yeah, maybe, but,
says, possibly.
Hey, you have a few Isekai summons that you can pork over, and they, oh yes, have these three.
Buy
one Isekai and get two for free.
Yeah.
In that one, there's a bit of Ari Furetta, there's a bit of Shield Hero, and the classmate thing kind of reminded me of a Spider.
So Carl, do you have anything to say?
Yeah, no, I mostly agree with Jean-Luc. I've read the manga too, and I just have trouble remembering it. It just kind of drowns into.
I have trouble remembering it too. The only guy I remember was the captain of the guard, and I just thought I loved him. He was great. Why couldn't you have lived, goddammit? Hold the main character into a Ryan Chad.
Yep.
Okay, next series, let's go.
Next series, moving on to Yenon. Title is Book and Bond and Book, The Only Way of the Operating Room. Musubu Tohon, Geka Shitsu no Ito. I looked into it. It's probably Surgery Room in the original. Publisher is Enterbrain under the Famitsu Bunko imprint. So far, there is one volume out, came out last June. There's a very short summary. Yenon doesn't have his titles on its homepage yet. So Musubu is a boy who can hear the voices of books. One day he meets a children's book who wants to go back to someone named Hana, and the search begins. Will he be able to fulfill the book's request?
So this guy's like the book whisperer. Okay, that's kind of interesting.
And I think what I heard, it's the same author as Book Girl. Unless I'm mixing that up right now.
Yeah, is this one.
Oh, that makes so much fucking sense.
He made the
show about the chick who's obsessed about books, and now he's making the Book Whisperer.
Yeah, so there are definitely some parallels there. I only read the first two volumes of Book Girl. It wasn't bad, but...
I've heard good things about it, like Flies goes fucking crazy over Book Girl.
Yeah, I still have two more volumes, and I think I'll read them eventually, but it's just not very high on my priority list.
Now, Carl, I do know that you've read a shit ton of Bookworm, so do you know anything about this series?
Not Bookworm, Book Girl.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah, different series altogether.
Extremely different series.
How many fucking book series are there?
Book Girl is the one about the girl who eats stories.
Oh, it's that one. Okay, now that makes a lot more sense. Okay.
Yeah, I almost wonder if those two are in the same universe or something.
That is actually a possibility.
It could be, you know, it could be leading up to like a crossover, like Avengers. You know, somebody could talk to books, someone could eat books. You know, it reminds me of that Cartoon Network show, My Gym Partner's a Monkey, where the animals would literally like eat books to learn. And the main character keeps on complaining like, yo, this Shakespeare is a little dry.
Actually, can you imagine what that is like when one character is starting to eat a book and the other one is, oh, don't eat that book, it's complaining. It's in pain.
Well, this sounds like an interesting series. You know, it could be fun because who knows what books could see.
Next series, also from Yen on, The Undead King's Reign of Peace, Fusai Tofushio no Saiseki. This one is also by Enterbrain and also by the Famitsu Bunko imprint. There's also just one volume out in Japan, and that came out last May. A young girl, Mira, on the brink of death due to an epidemic, is rescued by the terrifying No Life King, a skeleton of great power. As he continues to help and provide for her and others, the people around him eventually come to trust and rely on him. However, their peaceful life is shattered when the local ruler hears talk about sightings of a powerful undead and dispatches soldiers to put the threat down. Will the No Life King and Mira be able to achieve a world where everyone can live in peace when everyone's first instinct is to either fight them or run away?
This sounds like a more fluffy version of Overlord.
Yeah, like the synopsis reminds me of Demon Lord Retry, but not sure if it's gonna go the comedy route.
It reads more like a pacifist Overlord.
Yeah,
it's almost feeling more like a dirty way to defeat the goddess's heroes, something along those lines.
It's by the same author.
That's why.
Interesting. Anyone else got some thoughts on it? Because aside from like Fluffy Overlord, I don't have much to say.
Yeah, it sounds a bit interesting. I will probably pick up at least the first volume and see what it's like.
Yeah, I might give it a shot. Give it a one shot. Pardon me. All right, so we'll move on to the next one.
Yeah, next one is Maggie Stealth Bad Trip. Japanese title is also Maggie Stealth Bad Trip.
Bad Trip. Did he buy some like really bad meth or something?
It's a VR MMO novel.
Oh, not that type of trip. Oh, okay. I was thinking of a different type of trip.
Publisher is ASCII Media Works. Imprint is Dengeki Bunko. There are 3 volumes out and the series is complete with these 3 volumes. The story takes place in the near future. Money Master is the world's biggest VR online game. It is an open world game with no levels and no quests. The only goal for the players, known as dealers, is to make money. All sorts of illegal actions like violence and theft are allowed in the pursuit of Snow, the virtual currency. Due to the game's massive popularity, Snow has a significant influence in the real world, thus making the game's conflict part of the global economy. Each dealer has partnered with the Magisteris, a female support AI modeled after a supernatural creature which acts as their guide and support. Kaname Suo, the main protagonist, is a famous dealer with a succubus-type magistealth, is called Celica. Formerly part of the famous team known as Called Game, Kaname undertakes a mission involving the Inheritance, a set of cheat weapons created by a dealer known as Criminal AO that can break the game's balance and with it the world's economy.
I mean, listen, you don't need game-breaking shit to break the economy. Just keep on going money printer go burr. Like, it'll break itself.
Yeah.
Like, it seems confusing, but at the same time, if you know the author...
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Okay, who's the author? Like, who's the author of this?
Index.
Oh,
yeah,
no.
Yeah, Kazuma Kamachi.
Oh, no. Oh, the madman.
Yes, the madman has returned.
The human content machine is back. This time, he isn't just making bullshit out of magic and science principles. He's now going to do the economy.
Yeah, with gambling.
God. Oh, God.
So, let's say if this was by the author of Spice and Wolf, I might be interested to read it.
Well, listen, the person who did Spice and Wolf actually knows what the fuck they're talking about when it comes to medieval economics.
But to be very honest, I don't have much faith in the author of Index knowing his way about economic stuff.
Listen, he's so great at politics in Index, all right? You know, there's an intricate web of corrupt bureaucrats who, for some reason, never get fired or caught out, but do get caught out, but nothing fucking happens because reasons. Clearly an intricate writer. But yeah, the human content machine is back, so be careful, folks, on this one.
Yeah, but it's only 3 bucks, so...
Yeah, I guess you got bored of it.
Yeah, but I mean, for people that like it, his work, like picking up 3 book is not...
I mean, it's better than, like, Index is going on to what, its 50th volume as we speak?
Yeah.
I mean, I've never seen a guy who writes as prolifically as this guy. Like, I remember reading a story about how, like, he kept on being told to stop handing it, like, he would keep on handing in stories and drafts even though when even asked not to do it. Like, when I say this guy is the human content machine, he is literally the human content machine. Like, he keeps writing and writing and writing and going and going and going. He just doesn't stop.
I think his editors are afraid to tell him to stop. I mean... I love Index. I love Heavy Object, but not everything he writes is gold. And
Heavy Object is by the same author as Index?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh,
Blood Sign is by the dude who does Index. I think I can't pronounce it, but it's the one with the Stole Spirit or something. I can't pronounce it. I know the name, but he did that too. Like, the guy does a lot of shit. Like, I think he's done like 6 series.
And Index has 40 volumes altogether, and Heavy Object also over 30?
No, Heavy Object, he releases more sporadically. I think it's only at 15 or so.
Maybe I'm mixing that up.
Yeah, Index literally has like almost 50 volumes at this point. So, like, I loathe to see the size of the omnibus volumes when they come out.
Yeah.
I mean, the print is going to fucking blow up, that's for certain. Like, you just going to have this extra fit light. Like, this is a light novel. And it's about, like, the fucking size of a Bible, of, like, the Gutenberg Bible. Oh, God. Anything else to say?
No, I think everything's been said.
right, yeah,
I just feel like this series is one where his editor should have just told him to stop, but they simply couldn't.
If it makes money, it makes money. I mean, yeah. You know, why waste a gold mine like him? Because, you know, I mean, he must be making fuck ton of bank.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, but the thing is, if he doesn't have time to spend,
I think he's just spending it on like the power bill because he's probably keeping the lights on to like so he can keep writing. Like I'm pretty sure this guy only sleeps like a couple of hours a day. I think he actually said that in an interview. That only sleeps like a couple of hours a day. So this guy is, as the Brits like to say, an absolute mad lad. But he'd be fucking great at parties.
Okay, so that would certainly be interesting.
All right, so next title.
Next is the last title from Yanon. Make You Labyrinth Kingdom, a tactical fantasy world survival guide. Japanese title Make You Kingdom Damu Tokushu Butai SAS No Osu No Isekai Dungeon Survival Manual. Publisher is Kadokawa. Imprint is Dragon Novels. Seems to be a new imprint. I think I haven't seen any other English release from that imprint yet. There's one volume out in Japan and that was released in 2019, so it might be standalone. I couldn't find anything.
I mean, if there's no other volumes out, then it's possibly a standalone or a one-shot.
Yeah, so I'm not sure about that. If not, then it's been over a year since volume one.
Yeah, usually after that's not a good sign.
After being transported to another world with one man's mission is to rebuild a kingdom. He has a very particular set of skills and he's ready to face any obstacle because who dares wins. Monster, dungeon and war stand no chance against the special forces. That sounds like a Google translation. So got it from Mal because, as I said, Yanon doesn't have any official blurb out on their homepage yet.
Yeah, as you can tell, folks, we're kind of getting this like hot off the press.
Yeah, it's not that it's been over a week since they announced it. But Yanon is always a bit slow getting the new titles up on the homepage. JNC is always, as soon as the announcement goes out, they have the site up and even the first one or two chapters out.
Yeah, like I'm thinking that like Sam probably has like good IT people on his team. I think the Impress maybe.
And Yanon doesn't. So Seven Seas is a bit in the middle. This time they also had their sites up, but I've also had the case where Seven Seas was a bit late. So Yanon is always, and their site is also very disorganized.
Yeah, it needs needs a tune up. It needs a little bit of a fix up. But anyone have anything to say about the series?
Well, as Mirage said, like he's not sure that it's a one shot or not. But if you look at the cover, like there's not even a one on the cover, so it might be a one shot. And also, it's by the author for Other Side Picnic.
Oh, okay, interesting.
So all four Yanon titles are from authors we have other titles for in English.
Yeah. I could see that. You know, they want to like because you know. Some of these guys' works did well in English, so they're gonna test the waters a bit. All right, that's interesting. I see the play. I see the hustle that's going on. Okay.
So the blurb is relatively short. We don't know much about it. It, like I said, it seems like it's Google Translate. It's basically about a guy from the special forces who gets to another world and kicks everyone's ass.
I mean, if you see like the Green Berets or the Spetsnaz or like What's the German special anti-terrorist forces?
GSG-9.
Yeah, those guys are some scary fuckers. I don't know who I would... I don't know, but, you know, special forces aren't be fucked with. Like, it could be interesting. It'd be fun to see, like, a military man, like, just blow from fucking...
Maybe realist hero with... Where the new king is actually going the action route instead of the economic and political route.
Oh, man, if Soma was, like, a black ops guy, that would be fucking wild. He's like, all right, crossbows in position. Yeah, all right, get rid of charge. Phalanx in position. And they just like, dude, it'd be like an assassin, like how a realist assassin rebuild the kingdom. One murder at a time. Yeah.
Next title, and we're going for the one Yanon announcement and one JNC announcement. Culinary Chronicles of the Cordflower. Japanese title Ikakokyu Yorijo. That's something about cookbook, if I translated it correctly. It's released in Japan by Kadokawa Beanspunko. There are 11 volumes out in Japan. The series started in 2016 and finished in 2020. So the volume, the series is complete at 11 volumes. Hmm. Rimi has spent most of her life making food for the protector god of the land. She is suddenly sent as a tribute to the great empire of Konkoku, becoming one of the emperor's concubines. She comes close to losing the taste of her home country, but is saved by the gastronomist Jusei. As she dreams of a reunion with the kind scholar, she does her best to survive in the envy-filled rear palace with the help of her natural cheerfulness and her skill as a cook. Then, out of nowhere, she is arrested and sentenced to be executed on the charge of disrespecting the emperor. How will Wimi get out of this mess?
Man, find out her situation was 0 to 100.
A story about a princess and her love for food surrounded by gorgeous men.
This sounds like I'm always getting like villainous vibes from this.
I'm getting Apothecary's Diaries vibes from this, and not a few of them.
Me too.
Yeah, I've read the first two volumes out on JNC's homepage. It's basically Apothecary's Diaries with more Bishonen and with a less interesting main character.
Okay, that's interesting.
Not really bad, but Apothecary's Diaries is a high hurdle to compare it to. So maybe that's the problem here.
Yeah, this seems to have a more, direct audience that it's aiming for. Definitely looks to be going for the female demographic, where Apothecary was more universal.
So there are two chapters in, and already they introduced four hot guys. For her to two of them she's only seen from afar for now, but we all know how this is going to go. So one thing that should probably be noted, that it says in the blurb she's becoming one of the emperor's concubines. There are 120 of those, and only the top 40 are actually considered concubines, and the others are more or less serving women in the rear palace.
Who the fuck would have the libido to fuck that many women? Holy shit!
And apparently, the emperor is not all that interested in fucking with all those 40 concubines, because he's apparently one of the love interests. So he can't be shown fucking around with all the all his concubines, because then
is this like an Imperial China situation where like basically have these emperors that would like inherit these harems from like their fathers and grandfathers and shit like that?
No, the emperor is 16 years old and hot as they come.
Wow.
Actually, he's just become the emperor. That's why they changed out the whole harem and got all the new people in there.
Oh wow, holy shit.
They change out the old harem when the old emperor goes out.
Okay, that's good. All right, that's good. That presents this for a problem. Just kind of middle of the road series, I guess.
That's all of the new announcement. I think you wanted to talk about some physical releases.
And then we had a topic thing that Flies wanted to talk about it, so we'll include it here. Okay, but, so what's the thing about physical releases?
Yeah, so basically at the same time that J-Novel Club announced a Culinary Chronicle of the Cordflower, they also announced 9 titles for physical distribution. So basically they announced My Friend's Little Sister as it in for me. God.
Okay. That title sounds really rough in English, doesn't it? Like, it just...
Yeah, and I think is it just me, or is the cover kind of give me like side character vibes? Like,
I'm getting similar vibes.
I think it's the same artist.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Like, Well, at least this.
Yeah, always when I see that that cover, I think it's the next volume of Side Character.
Yeah, that's what I thought as well. But I think that this artist like stopped doing Side Character after the second volume, right?
I think it's third. Sure. Yeah, I think it's second or third.
Have to ask Alex.
Yeah, well, he's not online right now, so he'll be online like maybe in a couple of hours if he isn't busy working.
Yeah,
I'll probably chat to him. So.
Like it states, like if you're interested in that one, like it says that the release date for the first volume in the physical copy will be November 2nd, later this year. There's also, for a fan of Bookworm, there's Ascendance of a Bookworm official fan book. So this will be coming out on October 5th, if the source is good. Not really sure what it's supposed to be.
Is it like short stories or encyclopedia or anthology?
This book contains a slew of additional content, including all the color and cover artwork up to part 3, volume 1, a short story on some new apprentices, first tour of the temple, manga chapter by Suzuka, and 3-4 panel manga by Yoshina. Okay, so it's basically it's a fan book.
It's like a mix of a lot of things. Like you got a bit of art, got some manga, got a short story. Yeah, so if you want to hear likes Bookworm, pick that up. Looks like you'll enjoy it.
Yeah, that's nice for people that like this series.
All right, so getting to a more controversial subject. So
I'm not finished. Like, if you want,
I want to go into more drama.
Okay, so basically, let's go. The rest of them. So also announced for physical copy, Tearmon Empire, The White Cat's Revenge as Spotted from the Dragon King's Lab. Also, the light novel and manga for The Unwanted Undead Adventurer.
I actually read a bit of the light novel for that. It wasn't bad. It just wasn't my cup of tea. Like, I might try again and reread it, but I didn't really groove with it well. Didn't groove with me.
Actually, that one I find a bit surprising because it's quite an old title. So I think it's right now it's going to volume 7 or so. So that they would release it now after so much time, that's a bit surprising for me.
Yeah, yeah, maybe they wanted to give it some time to cook.
Yeah, and light novel and manga at the same time. Like, not sure if an anime is
Not sure if I want to buy the physical. Because the volumes are a bit short. I'm up to date with the series and I also quite like it, but I think compared to other light novels, those are a bit short and they cost the same. I'm not sure what as other titles, so I'm not sure if the pricing for this physical will be similar.
So also in physical, you have Her Majesty's Swarm. You also have Lily Blooms in Another World, and another one I'm not too sure why is the manga version for The Faraway Paladin.
Oh yeah, this will be fun. Yeah.
Yeah, but did they announce like physical copy for the light novel or
not yet? But they do have them in Japan. We just don't have them in English, apparently.
Okay, so I really wonder why they decided to go with the manga for physical version and not the light novel.
Yeah, well, maybe they read in Japan. They have like physical versions. Like I've seen a picture of like the author showing them off, so they have physical versions. It's just in English, apparently. Like no, you can't have physical version of this book.
I think in Japan they have physical versions for most of those.
Yeah. Yeah, but the thing, it's not the fact of not having the light novel in physical version. It's like, why the manga and not the light novel? Like for The Unwanted Undead Adventure, they're releasing like both in physical copy, but not Faraway Paladin, so not too sure why.
Here's the thing with the manga, is I think it's covering like volume 3 at the moment, but like volume 5 isn't going to be ready till like probably next year, and that's going to be like it's probably not going to be ready until like this year or maybe next year. So I can understand going off the manga to try and generate more hype for the series, but at the same time, like, it's going to be a while for like the story to keep kicking off, like to kick off again.
Yeah, but at the same time, like I did check check like the design like way back, and like it didn't really draw me in.
Yeah, like it doesn't fit with the series. Like I think it's all right. Like I don't think it's as bad as say like Infinite Dendrograms like manga adaptation, because holy shit, that is terrible. But I don't know. It just takes away sort of like the gritty aspect of it, because you know Far Ray Paladin kind of has like a bit of this grittiness to it.
Yeah, because like just looking at the cover for the manga, like it's, I don't know, it's like it doesn't look anything like the light novel. Like
yeah, like the light novel, like just by cover alone, kind of grabs you. Like you see this very picturesque, like young man staring at you, and behind him is like the undead creatures. It's like, oh, what's going on here?
And just reading the light novel, like you really get a vibe of like a more gritty, high fantasy-ish like story, but you look at the cover for the manga, and like it almost seems like a Final Fantasy cover or something.
Yeah, it kind of does. Oh yeah, speaking of Far Away Paladin, because Justice was taking a break, I've been further cock blocked and denied, but when he gets back, we are doing Far Away Paladin. I will not
In all due time.
Yeah, I guess. Anything else? Anyone else wants to say about physicals?
No, I think that's all.
Well, they did announce the physical version of Megumi Hayashibara's autobiography.
I think we talked about that last time.
I don't think we talked about the physical version, though. I know they announced the digital version before.
Okay,
I was pretty sure it was the physical last time, but
We'll keep this in just in case. It's better be safe than sorry. Everyone want to move on to the controversy?
Yeah.
So
don't have a lot of things to say about it.
Not much to say, but basically the TDR, and this is from what I've heard, is basically, so for volume 3 of Mushoku Tensei, apparently an editor basically removed some pages and took some shit out of the translation.
That's not it at all.
Did the story change?
Not the story change. You just got some stuff mixed up. Like it's volume 7 of Classroom of the Elite, like where the English version has a lot of missing paragraphs. So don't know exactly why they removed like a lot of text from the original version. But they admitted that they made an error, and they'll be re-editing and reissuing volume 7 for Classroom of the Elite. So for those that are buying those books, maybe try and get some information if they're offering refund or something.
I was thinking of the Mushoku Tensei thing as well, but
for Mushoku Tensei, it's volume 1 and 2, and it's like barely anything. Like I think it's like they tried to censor some like borderline stuff. Like in the first volume, I think they called like one of the characters a womanizer instead of a rapist. And in the second book, I think they replaced a scene where the main character tries to remove the panties from 9 years old. So they changed that a bit. And seems like a lot of people were not happy that they censored that. But
I can see why they do it, but at the same time, like, this was the author's, like, original vision as well. You don't have to like it, but it's like, hey.
What I don't understand is why they would start that doing that this far into the series. If they had done this from the start, Mushoku Tensei might have been one series that I would have thought to pick up, but now that the five or six volumes in, I'm not sure how far in they are at the moment. Anyone who's put off by that stuff won't be reading the series anyway.
Yeah.
So it really doesn't particularly matter anyway. Just like, you know, I just think it's a bit of a sus thing to do.
Yeah. And if they had started from volume one to cut out all of that stuff, then they might have increased their audience. But anyone who doesn't like us will not be reading the series anyway by this point.
Yeah, like Mushoku Tensei is one of those stories where if you like it, you like it, and if you don't like it, you're not gonna like it. You know, it's kind of like a new Shueisha work. You're gonna like it or you're gonna hate it. And and for Classroom of the Elite, you know, if any of you guys had that volume, or you know, try and get a refund or try and figure out what happened.
For Classroom of the Elite, I had a look at the Reddit post where they compared the passages, and from what I can see, they just cleaned up the prose a bit. The author is quite rambling in this one. They with the interior monologue of the characters. Oh, I'm cold, and yes, I'm really cold. And did I say I'm cold yet? So this is not that they censored anything. They just cleaned up the prose, and I think a lot of series could do with a bit of cleaning up the prose and
I don't think there's a problem inherently like trying to clean up something, like as long as like the meaning is still there.
And from the examples they had in that Reddit post, the meaning wasn't changed at all. So I'm for the Classroom of the Mushoku Tensei, yes, they did censor some of the more ranchy stuff, but for the Classroom of the Elite, I don't really see what the problem is about.
Okay, so that's less juice than I thought it would be, but like I don't read Classroom of the Elite, nor would I ever do, so I do hear I don't want to clue that here. People do some more investigation into it, like let's just see what ups, but like if it's just that, like them cleaning it up and making it flow better, I didn't see a problem with it. And the Mushoku Tensei one, I'm sorry dude, that's a little sus, but we'll keep it there for now. Anything else we should cover before we end this off?
Yeah, there's one last piece of news. Last year Yanon published I think it's out. They published on October last year In the Land of Leedale, and that light novel is going to get an anime version.
Oh, yes.
So, I don't know, like, much about the series, just that, again, the cover looks amazing. So if the anime is as amazing as the cover looks, I'm in.
Highly doubt it, but who knows? I could be surprised.
I'm not sure about that. I read volume one and I liked it. It's nothing extraordinary. The story won't win any novelty prizes, but it's a fun read, and
Okay. Well, yeah. I think we've basically exercised all the topics we have for today. So this is Bio Gundam. This is Bio Gundam, and I'm just going to, you know, end this and, you know, sign off. Join us next time when we cover Tentai books and play some miscellaneous light novel games, because God knows we have nothing else better to do. Bye bye for now. Play intro music. Dun 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 dun. Dun.
For show notes and related links, visit lightnovelpodcast.com.